substitute, so we can.
Is there a motion on the substitute?
Second.
Motion is second on substitute. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Substitute carries.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. House Bill 26-9 is a bill that was before you last year. It's an innovative approach to increasing transparency in healthcare pricing and rewarding patients who shop for high-value healthcare. Nearly everyone will tell you that they regularly comparison shop for the best deal when it comes to most any goods or services. But patients struggle to shop for healthcare if they can at all, leaving them to pay more than they should and contributing to the rising cost of insurance and healthcare generally. Commonly referred to as shared savings, House Bill 2639 empowers patients to shop for non-emergency elective healthcare services, helping to reduce their out-of-pocket costs and rewarding them for returning savings to their health plan and helping drive down costs for everyone. It's no secret that healthcare costs continue to rise. Insurance premiums and deductibles rise year over year. As a result, Virginians are faced with large deductibles to meet before their health insurance offers any coverage at all. So House Bill 2639 seeks to reward patients from day one for helping to bend the cost curve for everyone. A patient visits his or her doctor who recommends a non-emergency elective medical service. If the patient chooses, they can call or log into a shopping website to view a list of providers who can help in their network and at the same time evaluate their out-of-pocket costs for each one. Patients then choose the best location at the best value in consultation with a doctor. This legislation protects the right of a patient to receive care where they choose in consultation with their doctor. And if they choose a provider who charges less than the average cost in their network, the insurer shares a piece of the savings with the patient. This gives everyone skin in the game, even after they've met their deductible, and helps put downward pressure on the overall cost of care. Last year, Governor Northam implemented this program for state employees enrolled in state health insurance plan. DHRM estimates this program will save between 4 and 6.7 million annually to our state health plan. This legislation will bring the same tools offered to the state employees to your constituents in small group plans and help deliver savings to their health insurance carrier. I was pleased to make changes to the bill over the interim to make a more modest step forward and add support for the legislation. In particular, I want to thank Anthem for working with us to come to a consensus on this and be able to implement it. I also want to thank Delegate Toscano for joining me as chief co-patron, and if he wants to add any other comments.
Thank you.
You don't have to if you don't want to.
So it can be a love fest. I was going to thank Delegate Biden for bringing this last year. Remember, we had we had a long discussion about this last year. People were really intrigued by the notion of shared savings. Lots of folks were concerned about how it would operate. And so in the interim, I think people came together and probably based a little bit on what Governor Northam did, came up with a way of structuring this. I mean, we want a healthcare system that works better and costs less, and we want to be able to empower consumers to help that happen. And so this bill, I think, will do something. I mean, that's solving every problem in the world, but it interjects transparency into the process by which people can shop for various procedures, know what's out there, and then hopefully get some benefit, not just simply in terms of the deductible, but also some potentially some rebate benefits in the form of shared savings. So it's my hope that you will act favorably on this, and the states are again, laboratories of democracy and trying to figure out how best we can deal with healthcare costs that seem to be skyrocketing out of control. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Toscano. New members of the subcommittee, have any questions of the patron at this time?
utilizes a closed or narrow provider network, who this program might not make sense for, which shopping isn't as readily available in that approach, would make an exception for those programs. So, so those are the basic changes. This is going to help your constituents be able to, as the patron said, actually look at what their out-of-pocket costs are going to be for some of these common procedures and services, and make the best choice for them, and share the savings whenever they're able to deliver those. So thank you very much, and I hope you'll support the bill.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman and members of the Subcommittee, Nicole Riley with NFIB, representing about 6,000 small business owners here across the Commonwealth. We've asked our members about this particular issue. Well, I should say first, for healthcare in general, that has been their top concern for more than two decades, the rising costs of healthcare. And so we certainly then follow up with just recently this past year on this particular issue, and 77% of our members support this approach. So we certainly want to thank Delegate Byron and Delegate Castano for their leadership on this bill and taking this approach to incentivize, and hopefully, particularly with this blended small group market, the vast number of our members will hopefully see some benefit. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, members of the Subcommittee, Lindsay Berry-Winner representing the Blue Cross Blue Shield. I want to thank Delegate Byron as well as the proponents of the bill for allowing us to work on it to make sure that it was operational, that we don't increase premiums, but also afford members the ability to shop through transparency tools. I do want to close in saying that I do hope that we can continue to work on CMPN deregulation to afford Virginia consumers access to similar quality, lower cost sites of care. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone that wishes to speak in opposition besides that? Come on back.
I'm Doug Gray, Executive Director of the Virginia Association of Health Plans. We represent broad range of plans. I'm getting my first look at this arrangement and the language today. Yeah, it looks like it's headed the right direction, but I haven't had a chance to vet it with my members, and so I'm going to do that, and I'll get back with you. But it's clear that a lot of work has been done. I think obviously one of my members is very pleased. So, just wanted to let you know where we're with it, because I haven't had the chance to have it. But once I get that in, I'll come back and give you any additional feedback that might be. Thank you.
Absolutely. And this bill will not be heard in full for Tuesday. So,
okay.
Anyone else? Any further questions from the subcommittee? Subcommittee operates by motion.
Move to report.
The motion to report properly seconded. Members wishing to vote, please vote on the electronic voting board.
Okay, so I'm going to take the chairman's prerogative and kind of lay out how we're going to do the next four bills. They all deal with a subject that the Health Insurance Reform Commission looked at over the interim of our off session. And we put together a little work group that the Bureau of Insurance was involved with, that the different people involved, and try to get some feedback from them dealing with a very important issue as surprise balance billing. So we have a couple bills today dealing with two aspects of that. One of them is with emergency services. There's two bills that represent two different solutions that myself and Delegate Ware carry. And there's one dealing with ancillary services for non-emergency services that you will also hear about as well. So first, before we get started, I wanted to share a brief video for those that were not a part of the study that that was pretty extensive. I think we all came to an agreement at the end of that study, and it will reflect in looking back on the minutes of the HERC meetings, that everyone agreed that we needed to stop balance billing. The question was how we were going to do that and who was going to pay for it. So that's always the largest question that remains out there. So we'll be showing you those options in just a moment. Summer, and they continue to follow what Virginia is going to do to address the problem. It is a national problem. The Bureau of Insurance has also indicated that they're getting complaints from Virginia residents in regards to billing. I've received numerous emails from people that have been victims of balance billing, so it's a very serious problem and one that needs to be addressed. The president just did an executive order recently that addresses the large employer, because we don't certainly don't have any jurisdiction over that, but we do over the small employer and the private certainly affect what happens with our state employee plan as well. So with that, we're going to present two different solutions. There may be some similar things there, but we'll each present and then determine what the committee thinks might be the best approach. And I'm going to thank Delegate Ware for bringing forth language as well. And I would say you would probably surmise that he is bringing a view from the physicians that are being represented in that solution. I've heard some people say that my bill was the insurance. While the insurance may like it, I've made it very clear back in our meetings in the summer that my approach is patient first, and anything I can do to ensure that we keep our insurance premiums low and that the individual that's going in to get those services is protected the best way they can be. So with that, Delegate, where you have two bills, are you approaching both of those? You have, one says emergency, I'm not sure I actually understand which bill is the one you're.
We can take them any order you prefer, Madam Chair.
Well, is one emergency and one non-emergency, or is one combined both? I'm really not sure which is.
One of each.
So I think we'll start with the emergency one so we can keep that straight.
Okay,
and what is that number? Do we have a motion on House Bill 1714, substitute?
So moved.
All in favor say aye.
Principal provisions in this legislation are these. The first is that it
which is an unnecessary burden and a step that often leaves the patient confused and ultimately liable for the patient themselves. Patients are only responsible for deductibles, co-pays, co-insurance, and so forth, which are generally the patient's responsibility for in-network care. That's the basic structure of the measure, and I have several people that can inform the discussion.
Trying to make sure that we have the best and most qualified physician staffing on our emergency department.
any bill that undermines a fair payment to emergency physicians could undermine that safety net and leave Virginians without the best qualified physicians staffing their emergency departments, which is what we all want for our communities. When we have that unexpected emergency, we want to walk through the door and have the most qualified person there ready to take care of us, whatever time of day that might happen. The other part of this bill that's really important is the protection for the prudent layperson standard, which, as Delia Warrior touched on, if a patient comes in with chest pain and turns out to be acid reflux, they shouldn't be stuck with a huge bill. The last thing I want is an emergency physician, someone staying home and suffering a bad outcome that we could have prevented if they came in and sought our home, especially if they're staying home out of fear of a bill. Patients aren't doctors and shouldn't be required to diagnose themselves at home. Our bill prevents this practice by insurance, ensuring that health insurance is exactly that, insurance for the unexpected, and that patients are not unfairly put in the middle, and we hope you will support this critical protection. I'm happy to answer any questions, or I will turn over to my physician colleague.
Madam Chairwoman and members of the Subcommittee, thank you for the opportunity to speak today. My name is Richard Such, and I'm a practicing radiologist here in Richmond. I currently serve as the president of the Medical Society of Virginia. The MSV serves as the voice for more than 30,000 physicians, residents, medical students, physician assistants, and physician assistant students across the Commonwealth. The current situation with balanced billing related to the emergency medical care is untenable. Physicians want to ensure that patients receive the care they need, as you have heard, when they need it. And we are committed to making sure that what you saw in that video that does not happen to unsuspecting patients in the future. Physicians want to be in network with as many health plans as they can. Unfortunately, that's not always possible. Plans are not obligated to invite every provider to join. And sometimes they offer extremely low rates that are unsustainable for a practice. Patients and physicians should not, and frankly cannot, stop to sort out insurance information in an emergency. The Medical Society of Virginia is committed to a solution that holds patients harmless while working for both physicians and health plans. As part of the solution, as you have just heard, we propose prohibiting balanced billing for emergency care while ensuring that patients are paid a fair rate record. And as you have also heard, we're asking for the regional average of commercial insurance payments, which the Bureau of Insurance would help to verify in the event of a dispute between a physician and a health plan. I would ask that you support this reasonable proposal that will help to protect Virginia's patients. Thank you.
Thank you.
Members of the subcommittee, my name is Sally Matchett and I live in Hennepin County. Please forgive me, I'm very nervous. I've never been to anything like this. I'm not one of our lobbyists or legislators. I was a patient. I've been almost mimic what was shown in the video with my instance as well. On March 11th of this previous year, I went to the emergency department at an in-network hospital, and I knew this was to be in-network. I went, that's where I went there, with chest pains and shortness of breath. I thought I was having a heart attack. I woke my 18-year-old son at 3 in the morning for him to take me to the hospital. Thankfully, it was just my gallbladder, which apparently has the same symptoms I had. The doctor took great care of me, and 7 hours later, I was going to come. That's when the bills started coming in. I got a bill for $1,180 from a doctor's emergency group that I had never heard of or didn't even realize they were separate. I was confused, didn't understand who they were, and I learned that they were the ER physician group that staffed that hospital. I learned that my insurance, which was Cigna at the time, does not cover this group, and that the doctor's group was out of the network. As a result, this emergency group was billing me personally for the remainder of that payment. The most frustrating part is the hospital is in network, would have paid to the in-network price, and we settled the bill, which financially was great, but it didn't solve the problem. It was a kind of a quiet here, go away. So I asked the lawyer for the emergency group, how do we do this next time if I have to have another emergency? He said, well, give me a policy, we work with you. Which made me mad again that this is illegal. So I talked with insurance, and they said it's legal. Talk to your congressman to change the law. Talk to the emergency group doctors. They said it's legal. Talk to the congressman to change the law. I mean, talk to the state corporation commission, because I could not wrap my brain around this, that this would be illegal. And he said, unfortunately, he's got numerous calls for the same thing and said it is legal. Change the law. So, with this story hitting social media and the popularity of it being on social media, it was over 300 shares, over 600 comments on just the story on Facebook alone of similar situations to mine, whether it was an anesthesiologist that was somebody that was out of network, wanting to us to have a surgery with your doctor that you brought to an in-network hospital, both are covered, the anesthesiologist. Or you had a child, unfortunately, that had to go to a NICU. The NICU doctor wasn't covered in network where the hospital was. So all of these patients that are coming to me, since apparently I have a face for this bill now on television, I'm having the same problem. And I feel horrible and mad by it, because I know my bill is just $1,180. Theirs is emotional. So I don't feel that I have help here, because I don't work outside the home. My husband does. I don't have these extra monies to pay the balance of the bills for something that I'm making my premiums for each month. I have talked with my insurance carrier, Cigna, and said, okay, please tell me where your covered emergency doctors are so I can plan to go there if there's an emergency, if I can get to that facility. They gave me a list of, within the Richmond Tri-Cities area, 7 doctors, and they're not at 1 hospital. So how am I to plan my emergency to go to MCV and get John Doe if he's on shift that time? I have no choice in the matter. And that, I guess, is what is frustrating me the most, is there is no transparency, and they know, us patients assume, that the doctors are covered when in fact they're not. Since being involved with this, I've done a little bit of research. I certainly don't talk intelligently about it, but I've done my research and learned more about narrow networks and insurance gaps.
I need to try to get you to wrap up. I'm sorry, we have a lot of problems. I'm glad you came today. I was really laid it out very well for us.
Let me sum it up. I feel that this bill, 1714, we need to protect the patients, and we need to find a solution. We need to ensure that patients always have access to qualified physicians. Like previously was stated, she's trying to staff us with the best possible, and I believe this bill does both. But it also goes one step further by adding protections for me and you, the patient. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Any questions?
Okay. We have one more, because we're going to get to speak again, you know. Okay.
Yes, and Madam Chair, members of the Subcommittee, I'm Fred Rollins, Virginia Hospital and Healthcare Association. We've heard two stories today about this issue and how significant it is. I think everybody in this room probably has a story that's affected them in a similar fashion. The Hospital Association, we as an industry, acknowledge this is a challenge and a problem we have to address over the removing the patient from balance billing disputes involving emergency services, safeguard approved link versus standard, ensure fair and reasonable payment without creating an incentive to be out of network, encourage proper resolution of payment disputes between providers and carriers, and hold carriers, providers, and patients accountable for avoiding unintentional balance billing. This legislation checks all the boxes for us. It's a comprehensive approach. It's something that's going to prevent these issues from happening, those matters that are outside of folks' control. And, you know, we've talked around the issue of payment reimbursement. It's so critically important to make sure we strike the right balance. We don't want to create this incentive to contracting. Again, I appreciate the consideration of this bill as the support for the Hospital Association.
Madam Chair, members of the subcommittee, I'm Jill Henkin from the Virginia Poverty Law Center, and I want to thank Delegate Ware and Delegate Byron for submitting these pieces of legislation. I won't repeat. You all know how important this is, and we are really excited to see this very first step of dealing with the emergency room balance billing coming forward this year. Delegate Ware's bill does have a couple of provisions that stand out, a little bit different than Delegate Byron's, and that is the clarification of where an emergency is, the prudent layperson standard. It also specifically directs that the payment go to the provider, which helps to keep the consumer out of this issue. But as you might imagine, there still is a conflict between the plans and the providers about how much providers should be paid for services that they provide out of network. I want to suggest an addition to this bill, and I'm going to make the same suggestion for all four of the bills today, about an element that hasn't been considered in any of the legislation, and that is, I really believe we need another party in these negotiations, that being a state government, has a role to play in establishing rules and regulations regarding adequate networks of providers. Virginia does not have any meaningful, enforceable criteria today about what health plans need to offer in terms of network adequacy. And by directing the Bureau and the Department of Health to develop such criteria, we would be promoting negotiations at the front end of this discussion instead of at the back end after consumers go get services that they need and find out that it's out of network. So with the indulgence of the subcommittee, and I did present this to both of the patrons and talk to the various parties, there's not consensus, no surprise, but I'd like to present some language for you to consider as you look at these four pieces of legislation. Mr. Chair, is that all right?
Yes. You have it?
I have it.
Paper form? Okay. Is there anyone else that wishes to speak in favor of Delegate Ware's bill? Okay, so I think what Delegate Byron would like to do would be to go ahead and then present her bill, and then following that, we can take overall objections for anyone who's against either bill or both bills all at once, and we'll work through that.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. House Bill 2544. It's basically a pretty simple bill, and this comes out of all of our discussions. We heard from not only one of the victims who indicated that we have quite a few individuals that have experienced issues with balance billing, and first of all, I thank the group that met with her this past summer. We sat down, and everyone has really been trying to come together with a reasonable solution. But of course, when it deals with money, that's always difficult to do because nobody wants to let go too much. However, there have been solutions that have come to the table. The question is how much it's going to cost everyone. The bill that I have puts the patient first. You know, we talk about keeping the patient out of all of this, yet the patient is the one that continues to be a victim of it, because if we go with the version that Delegate Ware presented, then that's dealing with a fictitious figure of an average of commercial rates from the VHI, and those of us that are familiar with the VHI and the all-payer database claim that the figures are all over the place. The thing that I don't understand and that I've been trying to grasp, you know, we talk about narrow networks, and I agree with Jill in regards to trying to get adequate networks. That's all a result of what's happened the last several years with the ACA, and our networks are getting narrower, and if we had COPN reform, we'd have more competition too. So there's a lot of things that are falling prey, but somewhere we have to stop and say, we're gonna do something for the patient. Those people that are covered under other things, the large employer, what I just referred to, don't have to pay this. The individual that is a Medicare patient doesn't get balance billed for anything, and they're not going to be subject to us deciding who pays for it. I don't believe Medicaid pays for balance billing, but I'll let the insurance providers come up and determine that. So the bill that I have, and I also feel the responsibility for emergency services, when the hospital provides all these services and they have other people within that establishment that are a part of their business, that are not in their network, that there's a responsibility there too. How many people walk into a business with a blank check and don't have any idea when they go in what that service is going to cost them? But most patients go in with their insurance card knowing most times what their copay is to walk into that emergency room. What they don't know is if there are other services that they're going to need in there that are going to cost them thousands of dollars later, that are going to end up in a credit collection situation and a result of many financial nightmares that I've heard. So trying to address this issue is pertinent, and then addressing it in the proper way where we do not increase insurance premiums or increase the cost to patients is also equally as important. The bill that I have does not allow for an individual to be balance billed for covered services except for your co-pays, your co-insurance, and other cost sharing that you already have for non-covered services. And it takes the average of the contracted commercial rates paid by the health carrier for the same emergency service in the geographic region where the emergency service was provided. And then we also included on line 44 that the out-of-network provider may request the Commission's Bureau of Insurance to determine whether the benefits that the health carrier has determined satisfy its obligations. So it gives them an opportunity to bring their disputes in front of the Bureau of Insurance. So I believe that the bill that I have coming forward protects the patient in the best current manner. It's the most simplified. It isn't using fictitious numbers that have to be calculated through another government agency. And it is best for the consumer and will not affect the insurance premiums going up. Now, I have great sympathy and respect for our emergency doctors that are caught up in this as well. But I believe the patient needs to be the one that comes first, and the business needs to work out their issues second. So with that, I'll let some of the folks that can explain some of this a little bit better in regards to the rates come up and do so.
Anyone that would like to speak in favor of Delegate Byron's bill, come on up.
Mr. Chairman, and Mr. Gray, I'm Doug Gray, Executive Director of the Virginia Association of California. We prefer Delegate Byron's bill because it relies on the existing negotiated rate of the plan negotiated. Delegate Ware's bill basically gives providers a raise and an incentive to leave the network.
and our networks, which were already challenged, at the same time. It doesn't really make sense to us. And I guess if I have concerns about, other concerns about the other words, but I guess you'd like to hold them, or you'd like me to talk to them. How about them now? I mean, because we're kind of talking about what we like.
Chairman, members of the committee, I'm Robert Ferrari here on behalf of America's Health Insurance Plans. And we prefer Delegate Byron's bill over Delegate Ware's bill, mainly for the points brought up by Mr. Gray, but most importantly because of our Delegate Byron's bill preserves our ability to create viable networks. And as you deliberate over these issues, use that as a guideline. You know, does this bill or does that bill preserve our ability to have good networks and create network adequacy, which is very, very important. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman,
Paul Rowe,
Denver, mutual the interested parties to go, so I'm gonna jump in here. We haven't taken a specific position on either approach at this time, but as I've mentioned before, costs and premiums are definitely a concern for our members, and certainly we want to make sure that any approach that moves forward does two things, and that is one, protecting our members and their employees from surprise balance billing, and also making sure that we aren't doing something that would increase their premium costs. And so at this point, we're certainly watching and seeing how this will go through the process, but want to keep those two things in mind. Thank you.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, although I had presented the folks who were formerly part of my presentation, I am confident there are others, hospitals and others, who would like to speak in favor of my legislation, which we didn't continue to that. So I don't know what process you would like.
I think that's the juncture we're at, is trying to get the pros, so anyone that wants to speak on your bill, in favor of your bill, have them come on up.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. I'm Tom Burdett, representing Bon Secours Health Systems in Virginia, with systems in Richland, Rappahannock, and Hampton Roads. We are here today to support the measures that are being undertaken by Delegate Ware's bill, so we support that initiative.
Thank you.
Hello, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. Sam Gershmeyer with Central Health in Lynchburg, Virginia. We support the comprehensive approach in Delegate Ware's bill, but want to thank both patrons for their work on this issue.
Thank you.
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, James Pickrell, representing the Virginia Chapter of American College of Radiology, Psychiatric Society of Virginia, and Virginia Society of Plastic Surgeons. We are strongly in support of Delegate Ware's bill. I would urge you to consider it favorably.
Thank you.
Mr. Chair, Lauren Schmidt on behalf of the Virginia Orthopedic Society, and we also support Delegate Ware's bill.
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, I'm Tracy White, representing HCA Virginia Health System, and we strongly support Delegate Ware's bill.
Thank you.
Mr. Chair, Ashley Nall on behalf of Ballard Health, and we support Delegate Ware's bill.
Thank you. So is there anyone else in favor of Delegate Ware or Delegate Byron's bill? Okay, in this unconventional way that we are tackling these two bills, then I guess we can go ahead and have anyone come up. If, particularly if you have objections to both bills, please state that if you object. We're taking your bill first, Lisa. We'll go is the people who represent the most Virginians. So what this bill does is raise the cost of an ER visit for the largest number of Virginians. That's what it does, because we are a volume-based business, and the carrier brings the most to the table gets the lowest price. So once you've raised the price and you reward the provider for leaving the network, they will never come back. The status of our networks today is we have most of them in network, but not all. Once they see the opportunity to be rewarded for leaving the network, they'll all leave. And what we'll have is a much higher price. And that higher price will be borne by the consumer. When they have a high deductible plan, they will, and they haven't reached their deductible and they go to the ER, they'll pay that higher price out of pocket. And then, once they reach their deductible, if those costs are passed on through the insurance pool, then their premiums will go up. And again, they and their employer will pay a higher price. So that's the challenge with this approach. It's good to eliminate balanced billing. It's not good to take that as the opportunity to increase costs for everyone and ruin the network. And that's the challenge with Delegate Burr's approach. In regard to the prudent layperson, it's in the statute already. It's already required. The suggestion that plans do not pay claims in an emergency is wrong. We are not allowed to not pay a claim in an emergency. We are prohibited by law from doing so today. Members of the Bureau of Insurance are here. If we tried to do that, we would be written up in a market conduct and pay a fine immediately. We do not have the ability to not pay a claim that meets the prudent layperson standard. And the prudent layperson standard is in the code. It's pretty straightforward. If you feel like it's an emergency, it is. That's it. So messing with it seems to be more about something else, which might be about figuring out how to get payment for claims without documentation. We have a lot of upcoding problems in the ER, where things are coded at a higher level than they actually are. Do we ask for more documentation before paying a claim then? Absolutely we do. Why do we do that? Because it's required of us to be responsible stewards of the pool. So that's why we do what we do. Jill's comments about the network. How could we possibly satisfy a network in an environment where there's one hospital in town and they've given an exclusive contract to the ER practice for the hospital? That is the example that Sally Magic ran into. Exclusive hospital contract with an exclusive group of providers. They didn't want to accept a reasonable in-network rate, so they held out. They figured, you need this hospital more. Why? Because we're required by law today to have an adequate network. And they knew we were on the edge of not needing it, and we're trying to use it to leverage a higher rate. We already have that challenge today. So these challenges are going to be exacerbated by Delegate Burr's approach. The purpose of this whole study was to help a consumer with balanced billing. Eliminating it is the right first step. I would say that going beyond that to requiring higher payments isn't going to help that consumer, and nor their premiums. And that's the challenge with Delegate Burr's bill. Delegate Byron's bill basically leaves it where it is today. And the ACA put the three standards in the code today that are there, and that's what we follow when we have an out-of-network payment to make. And so I actually think we're inching towards the right direction, but I think it would be a shame if we did harm to the consumer in our attempt to, quote, help them. That doesn't make sense.
Do you have a question for
Doug? I'm not sure who can answer it. It seems, though, to me, that in regards to the payment beyond what the insurance would normally cover, that the two bills use two different methodologies to determine that payment, right? Both sides claim that their methodology is fair. Is the one in Kathy Byron's bill the current methodology that is used to determine the payment beyond what the insurance company will pay?
Mr. Chairman and Delegate, yes. It's based on what was negotiated as the
have, in Doug Ware's bill, a different methodology to do that. The way I understand balanced billing is, say I go to the emergency room and the, we'll just use Charlie. So, you know, my insurance would normally pay $800 or whatever it is, but then I'm using out of network doctor. And so the insurance company says, I'm gonna pay you $800. But the hospital says, okay, well, the cost of that doctor was $1,200, so the $400, the balance comes to me, correct?
Correct.
So, as I understand it, we're gonna eliminate that, and that $400 has to be made up and costs somewhere, right?
Mr. Chairman and Doug, I would argue no, it doesn't have to be made up. The practice of charging an extra $34,000 to someone who broke their nose is not acceptable, and it should not continue. And it doesn't need to be replaced or made up in a bill to address balance bill.
Okay. And I agree that $34,000 is exorbitant, absolutely. How much do you think if we use Delia Ware's methodology for payment would increase premiums for the average Virginia consumer?
Mr. Chairman, Delegate, what I think it would do is take an average of out-of-network payments and in-network payments. So it's not just the in-network ones. And it would create some compilation. So it would make a pretty sizable increase for people who are with carriers who have a pretty good volume. A large number of enrollees will have the best deal. And they're those consumers. So the consumers with the most populated plan will see the biggest increase. The ones who have a plan that's close to full charges probably won't see much of an increase because they're close to paying full charges. So if you are in a plan that can't warrant a discount of any size, you're not going to see a huge change. If you're with a plan that can warrant any discount at all, you're going to see an increase.
Delegate Cole.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I had a question about a slightly different topic. One of the things
is this
that,
for Doug or who's
well, I guess for Doug, that's okay. One of the things that surprised me was that process of sending the check directly to the patient. At least in the legal field, if we receive a settlement, the client, our first obligation as attorneys is to hold that into escrow until it can be then paid to those people who are still owed money. Can you describe for me the justification for the process of sending that bill directly to a consumer who more often than not might not understand that they still owe money, might see it as a windfall, and then find themselves in collections?
Yes, Mr. Chairman and Delegate Cohen, if you're in a situation that that was described in the video and you're about to be charged another $35,000, it would likely be that the relationship that you have is between the enrollee who bought a plan from the insurer and the company. The insurance company and the enrollee have a relationship. The physician who is charging the $34,000 doesn't have a relationship. So we would not send the payment to someone that is not agreeing to a contract that protects our member. We would send it to the person we're trying to protect, our member, so that they would have it as they try to negotiate a settlement for the extra amount that was sent to collection. So the idea is to give some protection to the person that we have contracted with, that is our member, because the provider who's trying to get extra resources out of them is not a member. So that's the reason why it happens that way. But that being said, if we're going to ban balanced billing and we come up with an appropriate payment based on what we negotiated as an in-network rate, then the discussion for paying directly is open because they're protecting our consumer, and you have protected them by passing a bill that prohibits balanced billing. Some have it as a regular practice and do it as a matter of routine. Others only do it when they have a problem or a situation in a particular area.
So it's, pardon me, Mr. Chairman. So it's a means of being able to negotiate with the health providers at that point?
It's a means to protect the patient. The patient is the one who's negotiating with the provider. They're the ones who are at being exposed. We're just trying to assist them by giving them the ability to handle the situation as best as they can.
How often do the people who are in receipt of that payment actually go back and pay some of the bill as opposed to finding themselves in collections for $25,000?
Mr. Chairman, I think most of the time after they get to a reasonable settlement. But they don't give it away before they have an understanding about what the extra amount they're liable for is, or else the entire amount goes to collections. And that's when they have a problem, which is exactly what happened with the situation in Falls River.
Thank you.
Lucky Weber.
So as I understand it currently, part of the issue, as Dr. Mullen alluded to, is that or talk about it, is that the direct payment to the physicians. If we balance bill, correct, we're eliminating this, so for instance, the lady that had $30,000 all of a sudden, so we're eliminating this thing that's going on. And if we establish a methodology for paying the hospitals, et cetera, why is that, would that not be eliminated? So you could pay the doctor directly so that they could pay faster?
Yes.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, if the amount was our negotiated in-network rate, that is exactly what we do with our in-network providers. We pay them directly. So it would be a strange practice at all. But if you pick an amount and describe a delegate Ware's bill, which is much larger, and we pay it to them directly, they will never join the network because they'll make more for being out of network than being in.
What is the difference in dollar amounts between the two methodologies of payment?
I just want to comment on one thing. They talked about using VHI and all payers database. For those of us that have fought the COPN reform issue, well, I think it's great that we saw the hospital lobbyists come out and all the other medical community, and we certainly respect their services and we want good medical service, but you have to be able to afford it too. And the APCD rates that we looked at that we used multiple times to give information out as to why there needs to be reform of the Certificate of Public Need shows rates all over the place. You may see an imaging that's $900 or $1,000 at one place and 150 somewhere else. So you're gonna take the average of those two, you're gonna end up paying more. That's the biggest concern, is that you need to protect the patient. We are at a point where the only ones that are left paying anymore are the ones that are struggling to pay for their own insurance. So they keep subsidizing everybody else and we keep dumping it on them and they never get a break. And that's what this bill is about. If we're really gonna fix it, let's fix it for them. You know, the impact on this, I checked because, you know, certainly I was concerned that there might be a impact to the state employee plan. If we are using that methodology, it's gotta cost more. So as I was checking on other bills, I asked for a statement and they have been reviewing it, a preliminary statement that says there will be they see a potential for a tremendous impact to the state employee plan, and it's an indeterminate amount, but there's a grave concern, and they're trying to get a final to me as soon as possible. I would hate to see us lose an opportunity to correct this measure by not doing the right thing. You don't want to raise rates.
Delegate Tobor.
Yeah.
We're process. I mean, I heard Doug Gray say that, you know, it looks like we're just going to be raising the floor, it's going to raise prices. Can you alleviate my concerns on that so I can get to where I need to be?
I think it's looking from a friend over here.
usual and customary for that insurance company like it is today, Medicare like it is today in the statute, and the third one is a fair market value. Looking at what's paid out there, a fair market value, the greater of those four on the delegate orders bill will be paid.
Who makes that decision on the fair market value?
That is something between the health care provider and the insurance company. The insurance company is going to make a payment. The health care provider is going to get that payment and either say, yes, that's fair, I like it, or no, I don't, and they'll ask for reconsideration to the insurance company or may appeal it to the insurance company, or in delegate Ware's bill would have the option, if they can't work it out in good faith with the carrier, to go to the Bureau of Insurance and say, did I get paid the higher of those four categories?
Right.
And I'll hand over to Mr. Roy.
Just a comment on the rate issue. We've heard multiple times that the standard is going to become under this bill the average in-network amount. If the average in-network amount for that carrier was sufficient, the provider would already be in network. It would be a sufficient payment amount. And so you're establishing this floor. It is artificial. It's determined and it's unilaterally determined by the plan. You don't have a lot of variation in professional services across the state when it comes to the plan. You might have variation in energy services and other things like that, but you don't have professional services. So you're establishing that floor. If you're assuming that there's a reason why they're out of network is because they're not getting paid enough, you're going to ensure that that happens. And this issue about costs, maybe having an incremental increase on what happens as a result of this bill with a different payment standard, you may have an incremental increase, but at the end of the day, you have to cover your costs across that healthcare system or across that professional group. And so if you're going to squeeze it on one end, it's going to pop up on the other. If you're giving a license to shortchange providers in this area, they're going to have to make it up somewhere else. Somewhere it's going to come out of the system. It's not going to be from this plan, it might be from the other. So we've got to keep that in mind. In terms of healthcare costs, there's a lot of things we can do to reduce healthcare costs. That's why we have insurance plans. That's why we have managed care companies. Getting the right care at the right time, not going to the emergency department, is a lot cheaper than going to the hospital in the first place and having to go that route to get the care that you need. So if we want to talk about controlling costs and talk about controlling premiums, we're paying as part of our premium to get managed care, and that's part of the goal here. So just keep that in mind.
Which one of the bills, one of the bills has direct payment, one of them has patient payment. Which bill is which?
Delegate Ware's bill, Mr. Chairman, Delegate Gilmore, Delegate Ware's bill has direct payment to the provider. Delegate Miner's bill does not.
Okay.
Is there anyone else that would like to speak in opposition to Delegate Ware or? What you got, Robert?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Not a lot. I'm here to speak in opposition to Delegate Ware's bill. And I'm representing America's Health Insurance Plans. I just want to talk to you a little bit about that payment mechanism, which is based upon the All Payers Claim Database, which you probably know is a voluntary system right now. Not all plans participate in it, and it's also backward-looking. So, for instance, if you're using that as a mechanism and a couple of the plans pull out and don't report their data, then what are you going to base it on? So it is fundamentally flawed from the beginning to use that as a mechanism to figure out what the rates should be. Now, I want to tell you, though, that the biggest problem here is when someone goes to an out-of-network provider, and I'm going to say it again, it's because the network provider, or the provider is out of network. If the provider is in network, there's no balance bill. So that's the problem in and of itself. So anything you do, again, to undermine our ability to attract providers into the network is going to be counterproductive. This is going to continue to cycle. I just want to leave you with one other point, and that is everybody that you heard in support of one bill were providers. And that should give you some indication of where that's coming from. So again, think about the patient. It's the patient and the employer that are paying the bills, and they're about quality care that's affordable. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, so do we have anyone who wishes to speak in opposition to Delegate Byron's bill at this point?
question about the payment.
Yeah, I'm concerned about that.
Well, I'm concerned about the additional cost as well, and the additional cost of the state health plan. So if we agreed on the language in my bill, this is not, remember, this is surprise balance billing. This is not balance billing. So we weren't, in the summer, we weren't getting into that whole issue in general across the board. So in this particular instance, I would be agreeable to an amendment that would allow that to go directly to them if that was the agreed upon thing.
Okay. So is there anyone who wishes to speak in opposition to Delegate Byron's bill?
Yes, sir. Mr. Chairman, Scott Johnson again. I neglected to thank both Delegate Ware and Delegate Byron for their work on this. The problem we have with the approach taken in Delegate Byron's bill is you leave all of the determination of payment in the hands largely of the insurance company. So if balance billing is created, you've tilted the scale, and the ability of the providers to negotiate a fair in-network rate is going to be tilted in favor of the insurance company. That is an untenable position. As Mr. Rawlins said, healthcare costs have got to be covered. And in her bill, there is no fair market value approach. There is no concept of something that, in essence, is a third-party approach, and that's what we think is essential. Her bill, as you noted, does not have direct payment. The bill does not address the prudent layperson standard with the final diagnosis that the patient came up and testified about, and does not have the protections in there for the Bureau to do sufficient work. So we would ask that that not go forward.
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, Brian Rollins, Virginia Hospital Healthcare Association. You've heard enough from me today. I just wanted to formally register our opposition to this measure. Thank you.
Hi, Dr. Patricia Annis, emergency physician again. I just wanted to register my concern about some intended consequences with the Delegate Byron's bill. Using the average of contracted commercial rates paid by a health carrier, which is the language in there, is essentially allowing health plans to price set reimbursements to physicians. It doesn't allow physicians to have any negotiation at all. And there's no transparency in that either, because nobody really knows what the average of the contracted commercial rates are, because that's proprietary information that my physician group can't even talk to another physician group about what they get paid, because it's proprietary. We were trying to find something that's more transparent when we were developing the language in our bill, something that could be verified and validated and was less opaque. I think there's a move in healthcare, as the earlier bill that was proposed, is to make things more transparent so that patients know what it costs when they walk in somewhere. And so that's why we had chosen that payment structure. I do not think that the fears of raising premiums make a lot of sense, because it's the regional average for commercial payments that are already being made in 2017. So these are the payments that were already being paid in 2017. We did it that way because we didn't want it to seem like there was some advantage that physicians would have and now they would pull out of network in an effort to increase what we're being paid. That's not our goal at all. The goal of the legislation that we built was to protect patients on multiple fronts and also ensure that the healthcare safety net stays intact and emergency departments stay staffed so that patients have access to care when they need it, without us tearing any holes in a safety net that's already quite stretched. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Delegate Gilmore.
Sticking point between the two bills is how much people are going to in regards to this, because we want low cost for our consumers, but we also want a high quality healthcare system as well. And so it sounds like there's a give and take there. And I also think, as Chairman Kilgore mentioned, there's some good things, the direct payment, but also that we end this balance billing. So, Mr. Chairman, I would move that we move 2544 and
1714
report to full committee.
So we have a motion and a second, but I'm not sure that it's actually proper because we can't move these bills in a chunk. We're either going to have to pick them up one at a time.
Oh, sorry.
Or,
I apologize.
Or Chairman Kilgore, if you would prefer, we can leave them here and have them simply move forward to the full Commerce and Labor docket for a date to be determined. If you would prefer to do it that way,
we could do that.
So just essentially advancing the full committee to be heard without actually having.
Can a member of the committee speak to that? Mr. Chairman, I would just say that I understand the position sitting up there on the dais that many of you are probably sitting there wondering what you're doing. But at the same token, I don't want to be disingenuous by you thinking there's going to be some great compromise here, because there are two solutions. There are two different solutions. There's not. I find it hard after 6 months to think that there's going to be something where we all of a sudden have a kumbaya. Now, if you want more lobbyists to come out and visit you, that's going to happen. So you can count on that. My question is, are we going to represent the whole thing all over again? Or I was trying to move the process along because we have a really heavy docket. I'm not trying to rush you, but I'm also just trying to bring out some facts. Are we going to come before the full committee? I would prefer not to put it off for 2 more weeks. The whole purpose of presenting was to try to come to a consensus. So it's going to be a tough vote. And when you look at it, you're going to have to decide which way you're going
to go. Whoever, would you like to withdraw the original motion that you made?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Delia Ware, do you want to address the?
I'm not sure that there's a whole lot to add. I do think, in terms of balance, make sure that each side gets a chance to say a couple of things as we close. Let me know, if you eliminate balance billing, which is the case, I believe, in both pieces of legislation, it's a pay cut. And if we do that, we need to address what a fair payment should be. And that's why we took a fair market value approach. I think that's important. I think, heard on one side, what we heard from was providers, what we heard for exclusively on the other side were insurers. I would add there was one person who spoke for the average citizen, and this person spoke in favor of 1714. So I would note beyond that, those points.
Mr. Chairman, here's what I want to say. A bill is going to come out of the House, I think. So my charge to everyone who's interested in this piece of legislation is to work on this and try to come to as much agreement as you can, and then I think the committee is going to have to just make some calls on which route we take. But I am, like Delegate Weaver, I am concerned about the direct payment, that direct payment issue.
Really, I just told you we were going to spend
more. Concerns. So we have a couple of different paths we can take. We can advance these, not necessarily advance, simply put them.